for my Form 4 students. Today we are here to continue with the chapter Periodic Table of Elements. Okay, I hope before you watch this video, you would have done the answers for this module, Chemistry Form 4, this module from page 64 up to 68. Okay, so this video teacher will discuss about page 64-68, which is elements in period 3. Okay, so let's continue. Now, what do you mean by period? So, as when we were discussing the introduction of periodic table of elements, teacher was talking about groups which you will read from top to bottom vertically. Now, we are going to read periods. Okay, so period is read from left to right. Okay, so the elements in a period is read from left to right. Okay, if you look at the periodic table of elements, elements are read from left to right. Okay, now for your syllabus, teacher will be discussing of elements in period 3. Okay, so in period 3, please look at this page. You will find 1, 2, so, you will find the elements in period 3 starting from sodium ending with argon. Again, starting from sodium ending with argon. So, these are the elements even though there are no elements in the between. Okay, you can see from sodium up to argon. So, these are elements in period 3. So, this is included in your syllabus. So, teacher, throughout the whole video, teacher will be discussing about period 3. Okay, now, why are they in period 3? That's a good question. Why are they in period 3? So, why elements are in period 3? Because they have 3 electron filled shells. This is very, very important. Don't say 3 electron shells. Because sometimes the electron, the existence of electron shells not necessarily must have electrons filled with it. So you must be specifically telling the word 3 electron filled shells. For instance, electron arrangement for sodium. So this is the first sodium magnesium. For instance, if you read sodium magnesium aluminium. Okay, so aluminium. So the electron arrangement 2.8.1, 2.8.2, 2.8.3. Now class, if you see, you can see that they have 3 electron filled shells. Now our focus is not on the valence electron because the teacher have already discussed regarding the group. Now your focus must be in the electron filled shells. Can you see? Don't worry about the valence electron. Look at the electron filled shells. So that is the reason why from sodium up to argon. Teacher, give you an example. Sulfur, chlorine, argon. So you have sulfur 2.8.6, 2.8.7, 2.8.8. So these are the elements. So in between you might have silicon and phosphorus. Okay, so let me write this down. Silicon, phosphorus, 2.8.4, phosphorus, 2.8.5. So you read like this: sodium, magnesium, aluminium, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, argon. So if you see, all of them have only 3 numbers written. So that is the reason why we say 3 electron filled shells. Now, let's go to atomic radius. Oh, before that, when teacher explaining this, I want you to look at page 64 and 65, please. Now, please look at the table in page 64. Okay? Now, please look at the last part, which is atomic radius. The atomic radius of the element. So, you'll be surprised to find the atomic radius actually, you can say the atomic radius decreases when going across, not going down the period, going across the period, because your periods are read from left to right. So going across the period, you can find that the atomic radius of the element decreases. For instance, when teacher asks you to compare the atomic radius of sodium compact to argon. The first person is sodium. The first element in period 3 is sodium. The last element in period 3 is argon. So if you compare sodium and argon, you can find argon is smaller and sodium is bigger. Okay, so now why this happened? So the answer is in page 65. Please look at page 65. The answer is here. Okay, now what happens is these are the key points that you need to know in order to explain regarding the changes in atomic size. Okay, so now what happens is if you see elements have 3 electron filled shells. Okay, so no doubt about it. So all the elements from sodium up to argon, they have 3 electron filled shells, no doubt about it. But what happens is proton number increases. So what? When proton number increase, immediately electron, amount of electron, or you can say the electron arrangement and valence, electron arrangement with valence electron, electron increases. For instance, look at this. Sodium, the valence electron is 1. By the time you reach argon, look at the valence electron, already 8 already. Okay, so that's the reason why electron arrangement, okay, electron arrangement with valence electron increases. So what? Electron arrangement with the valence electron increases. There, this is the key point. Strength, or you can say force or attraction between nucleus and valence electron increases. So what happens is here the nucleus works once. Here the magnesium berkerja dua kali, the strength of attraction. Here aluminium, the nucleus have to pull 3 times. Let's go to sulfur. Sulfur 6 times because it has 6 electrons, valence electron. Chlorine, the nucleus will work 7 times harder. And your argon, the nucleus has to work 8 times harder in order to keep the valence electron. Why? Just one thing, treat your valence electron like money. Okay, so teacher give you 1 ringgit, you can just put it in your pencil box. You might even bother about it. But if teacher give you 80 ringgit, can you see the value is higher? You try to keep it safely next to you, correct? So the same concept you apply here. Higher the amount of money, the safer you try to keep it. So the same concept you apply here. Here, the force of attraction between the nucleus and the valence electron is only 1 time. Here, the force of attraction between the valence electron and the nucleus is 8 times higher compared to sodium. So, on the way, pulling the valence electron subconsciously, the atomic radius decreases. Decreases. Okay, so that's the reason why. Again, teacher repeat. So, see, atomic radius. Why atomic radius decreases moving across the period? Atomic radius decreases. Elements, they have 3 electron filled shells. So all the elements in period 3, they have 3 electron filled shells. No doubt about that. Now, proton number will increase going across period 3. So the electron arrangement with valence electron increases. I hope you can understand that. So electron arrangement with valence electron increases. Can you see from sodium, magnesium, aluminium, sulfur, chlorine, argon. Can you see the valence electron is all increasing towards from left to right. Okay. So what? Force of attraction between the nucleus and the valence electron increases. Why? Because the nucleus try to keep the valence electron to itself. So the force of attraction increases. Here the nucleus works 1 time. Here the argon nucleus works 8 times harder than compared to sodium. So you can imagine when it's keep trying to keep the electron to it, subconsciously it will pull all the electron shells towards it, or the other electron shells towards it. So that is the reason why the atomic radius decreases going across the period. Okay, now, so teacher have covered up to here. Now let's go to electronegativity. Okay, so let's go to electronegativity. What is the meaning of electronegativity? Electronegativity is the strength of atom to attract electron. Okay, so strength of atom to attract electron. For instance, sodium 2.8.1, 2.8.2, 2.8.3, then we continuing 2.8.6, 2.8.7, 2.8.8. So these are all the electron arrangement for the members in period 3. Now if you look properly, sodium, magnesium, aluminium, they are all metals. They are not supposed to attract electrons. Kalau boleh, they are supposed to give electrons away. They prefer to give electrons away. Now look across. Okay, if you look across, what is the story with sulfur and chlorine? Okay, so don't put argon in. Argon already achieved stable octet electron arrangement, so you don't have to worry about it. So let's go to silicon, sorry, phosphorus. Okay, so 2.8.5. okay, starting from here 2.8.5, 5, 6 valence electron, 5, 6, 7. Don't worry about argon. 5, 6 and 7. What do you think they need to do? In order to achieve stable octet electron arrangement, they have to accept electron or attract electron from elsewhere. Okay, your silicon needs 3 electron. Your phosphorus needs 3 electron. Your sulfur needs 2 electron, and your chlorine needs 1 electron. Okay, so that is what we call by electronegativity. So now, so electronegativity going across the period actually increases going across the group. Okay, so compare the electronegativity increase. Okay, so why it increases? Okay, why? Because of this. Okay, force of attraction between nucleus and valence electron increases. So this contributes to this. Okay, why? Because they are supposed to attract electrons. So the force of attraction between the valence electron, when it's increasing, what happens is the ability to attract electron from outside also increases. So that is the reason why. So the key point is force of attraction between valence electron and nucleus increases. So easier to accept electron, to attract electron. Okay, so all these notes are here. Okay, you can look at page 65. All the notes are here. So electronegativity increases going not down across period 3 from sodium up to, I'm not going to talk about argon. Argon, leave them alone, leave it plate for argon alone. Why? Because argon already achieved stable octet electron arrangement. So it does not need to share, receive or donate electrons. So we'll stop up to chlorine. So when you compare electronegativity of sodium compared to chlorine, chlorine has higher electronegativity. When you compare magnesium, this is magnesium, please refer here on your table on page 64. You can find that magnesium, if you compare magnesium with sulfur. Okay, when you compare magnesium with sulfur, you can find sulfur is more electronegative compared to magnesium. So that's how you compare. Why they increase? Because force of attraction between valence electron and nucleus increases, so easier to attract electrons. So that's the key points that you need to write. Alright, okay, now so let's go to page 66. Okay, so we're going to look at page 66. Hopefully, I've written the answers. Teacher already gave you the answers before we start this video. Okay, now, so change of properties. Let's go to physical state. Physical state, the change of properties. Now, when teacher say change of properties, that means you must understand I am talking from left to right. Okay, whatever when they say going across the period, it is definitely from left to right. I want you to remember that. So what happens is physical state changes like this. Metal, metalloid, non-metal. This is what I want you to remember. Okay, so now, so physical state as is, they will be metal, non-metal and metal, metalloid and non-metal. That means basically they will be solid, almost to semi-solid, then liquid. Okay, so that this physical state, we cannot exactly say who's non-metal. Okay, so now if for instance, like you can say sodium, magnesium, aluminium, they are non-metal. Silicon is metalloid, okay, because it's semi-metal, and the others are non-metal. So sometimes non-metal can be existing in a form of solid, liquid or gas. Okay, so that is the reason why don't like rigidly keep, oh, if metal means definitely solid, of course metal will be definitely solid. Metalloid can be semi-liquid also, so that's the reason why. Okay, so metallic properties, there which I already write down for you, metallic properties. So sodium, magnesium and aluminium are metals. Silicon, which has the electron arrangement 2.4, if you look at this, silicon are semi-metal. Okay, they are semi-metal. Okay, and the non-metals are starting from phosphorus, sulfur and chlorine, argon. Okay, so by the time you reach chlorine and argon, they are already gases already. Alright, okay, now, so oxide properties. Okay, now before that, let's go to electrical conductivity. Roughly, metal, sodium, magnesium, aluminium are metals, so definitely they can conduct electricity. Now, metalloid, semi-metal, which is your silicon. Okay, so silicon is semi-metal. Okay, this is a half metal, semi-metal. So this has a bit of problem. So it can conduct electricity. If you look at it, it is a weak conductor of electricity, but increases with temperature with presence of other substance. Okay, but it's okay, you don't have to go too deep or detail into it. Just say silicon is a semi-metal which conducts electricity at higher temperature. Okay, but so confirm sodium, magnesium and aluminium, they can conduct electricity in any state. Okay, now let's go to non-metal. Confirm non-metal cannot conduct electricity in any state. Okay, so you know that, right? Now teacher very interested to discuss about oxide properties. Now oxide properties is metals, when you react metals with oxygen, they turn into oxide. For instance, katakan metal X, you burn it with oxygen, it will turn into, just say, metal oxide. And you see X oxide. So this is what we call by oxide properties. So going across period 3, those who are metal, they will produce basic oxide. So basic means pH more than 7, react with acid. Okay, why they react with acid? Because they want to neutralize the acid. So basic, that means the metal, for instance, let me help you with this. Sodium reacts with oxygen to produce sodium oxide. So since sodium is a metal, the sodium oxide is said to be basic. Okay, it has base property, something like alkali. Okay, base property where it has pH more than 7 and can happily react with acid. Now let's go to amphoteric. This can be, okay, this one is only sodium oxide and magnesium oxide can do this job. Now amphoteric, you'll be surprised to find only aluminium oxide can do this job. Okay, now they are, if you look at, please look at page 66, okay, so you can find that this is what we call by amphoteric. Amphoteric in Latin means dual. Amphibian means can live in water and can live in land. Correct or not? So your frogs are amphibian. Why? Because dual. They have the dual properties. So amphoteric means they have the dual properties where they can react with acid and alkali. Meaning, plus when you put aluminium oxide into hydrochloric acid, you will find neutralization reaction. So that means basically your aluminium oxide is reacting with the acid. Now, scenario 2, you add aluminium oxide with alkaline, sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide or something like that. You can find that the aluminium oxide managed to neutralize your alkaline. So can you see, that is the reason why aluminium oxide has this special characteristics called amphoteric property, where it can react with acid and alkali. Different from basic sodium oxide cannot react with alkali. Okay, magnesium oxide cannot react with alkali, but they will be happily reacting with acid. This aluminium oxide can react with acid and alkali. Okay, now let's go to acidic. Who are acidic? Okay, so phosphorus, for instance, your sulfur, silicon, sulfur oxide, sulfur dioxide, silicon dioxide, and chlorine. Chlorine is acidic. So what example? Example. So what they do is they can react with cloud. Basic can react with acid. Acidic can react with alkali. Okay, so can you see the difference? Okay, now if acidic can react with alkali, so acidic substance react with alkali to go through neutralization. Basic substance reacts with acid to go through neutralization. Amphoteric, only aluminium have these properties. Okay, a lot asked in your question, Okay, so amphoteric, aluminium oxide is an amphoteric that reacts with acid and alkali. So it can neutralize both the substances. Okay, now to further support our explanation, now please look at page 67. Okay, so we are looking at the experiment. We are looking at the experiment where you can find the properties of oxide of period 3. In this experiment, we are using sodium oxide, magnesium oxide as basic properties, aluminium oxide to cover your amphoteric, of course, and your acidic, we use silicon dioxide, phosphorus oxide, and sulfur dioxide. Okay, so we are using these substances to test the acidity or basicity of the oxide. Okay, now if you see solubility of water, you can find that sodium and magnesium. Please look at page 67. Please refer to page 67 as teacher talking about this. Sodium oxide and magnesium oxide slightly dissolves in water. Okay, aluminium insoluble. The other, some of them are insoluble. So you cannot like surely pinpoint, oh, this is soluble, this is insoluble. But it's okay, not very important. The one I'm teacher interested is in your, can you see the towards the left hand side, towards the right hand side. Sodium magnesium basic oxide, pH 14 to 9, of course, pH 14 to 9. Aluminium, can you see there's a dash there? That means this color, this aluminium, actually you cannot find the pH already. Okay, or you can maybe say it's neutral, I did not say neutral, you can't find the pH. And can you see that type of oxide, it does not go into basic or acidic oxide. Now, look at phosphorus, sulfur and dichloride. Oh, you have dichloride, heptoxide. These are all acidic. Okay, so one thing teacher would like to remember, metals produces basic oxide. Non-metals produces acidic oxide. Basic oxide, sodium, magnesium, basic oxide usually. Acidic oxide, silicon and sulfur and also chlorine produces acidic oxide. Now, let's look at the next page. This is important. If you can, I want you to mark a huge star here. Please mark a huge star here. This is important. Okay, now, magnesium oxide Nitric acid. Now, magnesium oxide is a basic. Please look at page 68. Magnesium oxide is a basic. Of course, it reacts. So, the dissolve. Can you see the word dissolves? So, when magnesium oxide dissolves in nitric acid, for instance, magnesium oxide with nitric acid, this reaction happens. Magnesium oxide with sodium hydroxide, this reaction does not happen. Why? Magnesium oxide is a base, can react with nitric acid. Magnesium oxide is a base, it has somewhat property of alkali, cannot react with sodium hydroxide. Now let's look at number 2. Aluminium oxide can react with nitric acid. How do you know? You might be wondering, teacher, how I know that aluminium is reacting? Can you see the word dissolve? Please look for the word dissolves. The moment a substance dissolves, we can say that it is reacting already. Can you see? It can react with both acid and alkalis. So nitric acid represents acid and alkali. Sodium hydroxide represents alkali. So can you see aluminium oxide can dissolve in both? And next we go to silicon oxide. Okay, you add with nitric acid. Okay, no reaction, does not dissolve. But silicon oxide, you add with sodium hydroxide, it happily dissolves. So can you see the pattern? Magnesium oxide, basic, cannot react with alkali but can react with acid. Aluminium oxide, as an amphoteric, can react with acid and alkali. Silicon oxide, mowakili, has acidic properties, can react with sodium hydroxide but cannot react with acid, nitric acid. Okay, so now, so this is our chapter, subtopic, elements in a period. Okay, so I think you can understand. Again, teacher repeat, elements in a period is thanks to 3 electron filled shells. You read period from left to right in your periodic table of element. Okay, in your periodic table of element, you read the substances from left to right. For your syllabus, we will be looking at period 3. Okay, so these are all the electron arrangement of period 3 and the members of period 3. So, atomic radius decreases going across, not down, across period 3. Why? Elements are filled with 3 electron shells. Proton number increases. So, electron arrangement with valence electron increases. Of course, proton number increases, valence electron increases. Force of attraction between nucleus and valence electron increases. Thus, atomic radius decreases. Why? Here, sodium 2.8.1, the nucleus just works one times harder to pull the electron, to keep the electron, valence electron. Here, argon, the nucleus has to work 8 times harder to keep the valence electron. So that's the reason why subconsciously when the nucleus is pulling the valence electron, all the other electron shells will be pulled towards it. Okay, so electronegativity is the strength of atom to attract electron. So going across period 3 from left to right increases, electronegativity increases. Why? Thanks to this. Force of attraction between nucleus and valence electron increases. So easier to attract electron because I have the force already. So when I'm attracting, trying to keep my valence electron, subconsciously I can attract electron from outer from me. Okay, now change in properties, physical state, metallic properties, oxide properties. Okay, so physical, of course, solid, liquid, gas. Metallic properties, metal, metalloid, non-metal. These 3 are metal. This is semi, silicon is semi-metal. Up to phosphorus and argon are non-metals. Now, this is important. Oxide properties, you have 3 basic, amphoteric and acidic. Okay, so basic, amphoteric, acidic. Basic, they have pH more than 7, react with acid. Amphoteric, I won't talk about the pH. okay, and they can react with both acid and alkali, amphoteric dual, okay, and acid, silicon dioxide and your chlorine, hexoxide and all that, they can react with alkali to go through neutralization. Okay class, so teacher have finished periodic table of elements, elements in a period from page 64 to 68. Okay, our next video, teacher will talk on transition metals. Okay, so hopefully we can continue the class by this week or something. Okay, alright, so see you all. Have a good day.